Would you please turn your Bibles to John chapter 12, verses 27 through 36. John 12, 27 through 36. Now is my soul troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I have come to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The crowd that stood there and heard it said that it had thundered. Others said, an angel has spoken to him. Jesus answered, this voice has come for your sake, not mine. Now is the judgment of this world. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself. He said this to show by what kind of death he was going to die. So the crowd answered him, we have heard from the law that the Christ remains forever. How can you say that the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is this Son of Man? So Jesus said to them, the light is among you for a little while longer. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he is going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. When Jesus had said these things, he departed and hid himself from them. Universal Remedy for a Universal Epidemic is the name of the sermon this morning. You see, Jesus in these verses identifies an epidemic of unimaginable proportion. It's so great that it extends to every single individual that has ever lived. It crosses all boundaries of race, finance, education, social standing. There's no one that is able to escape the reality of what Jesus describes here. It's an epidemic that reaches us all. As all of mankind is dependent on air and breathes air, and we all have that in common. As all of mankind has a beating heart and blood pumping through their veins that sustains their life, and we all have that in common. All of mankind has felt the spread of what Jesus identifies, and we feel it by way of entrance into this world. By very virtue of being born, we find ourselves under what Jesus speaks of. You see, it's worse than a terrorist attack because of the eternal implications. Yeah. It's more certain than a financial collapse because it's not something we anticipate. It's already something that we've all experienced at the time of our birth, our natural birth. 100% of all people face this horrible consequence. And the experience of it is this is the eternal wrath of God. And the epidemic is sin. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. And that extends to every single human being ever born. No one is exempt. Not one. And just as this epidemic is inherited by all of mankind by way of natural birth in Adam, the remedy is available to all by way of new birth in Jesus. In these verses, we find a universal remedy for this universal epidemic. It's to look to the cross. It's been several weeks since we've looked at these verses, and as a way of reminder and review and context so we understand properly what Jesus says in our primary passage this morning in verses 31 through 36, we remember in verses 20 through 26, there was a rival of some Greeks that wanted to seek an interview with Jesus. They wanted to meet with Jesus, and it signaled to Jesus the ingathering of other sheep. And as a result, Jesus says, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. With the Greeks coming to him, he knew that it was time for the cross. In verses 27 and 28, as a result of this, Jesus says, now is my soul troubled. This was deep pain that he was feeling. It was a shuddering inside his very soul when he says, "Now is my soul troubled." But yet his chief was concerned in that moment was still for the glory of God. In verse 28, God confirmed that the entirety of Jesus' ministry glorified God. "I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again," and that is that he would glorify his name in the cross. In verses 29 through 30, the crowd responds to this, confirmation from God, from this voice, from the very voice of God, but they were unable to make it out. They were unable to understand what God had said. They offered up a naturalistic explanation that it was thunder, or maybe it was an angel. They didn't understand. And Jesus answers, "This voice has come for your sake, not mine. This was for you to confirm my ministry." And then in verse 31, Jesus states in untarnished words, the sealed fate of the world and the sealed fate of Satan. We see the victory Jesus wins in the cross is the defeat of the world system. This is the irreversible fate of the world system. This is the irreversible judgment and defeat of its ruler. Jesus says this, "Now is the judgment of this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out." Jesus states two things that result from the cross in verse 31 with the word "now." There are two victories that Jesus will accomplish in the cross. And if you look at verse 32, when Jesus says, "And I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself," you see the third victory of the cross. The first victory is judgment of the world. The second victory is casting out of the ruler of this world. And the third victory in verse 32 is that Jesus through the cross will draw all to himself. But he begins with this, "Now is the judgment of this world." How did Jesus in the cross judge the world? It's very simple. The world murdered Jesus. The world put Christ on the cross. What does that have to say about the world? The only perfect, the only innocent man that has ever lived, the world, what does it do with him? It kills him. It hangs him on a cross. Judgment upon Christ was all throughout his ministry. In chapter 6, verse 42, they said, "Is this not the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, 'I have come down from heaven'?" In chapter 7, verse 15, "The Jews therefore marveled, saying, 'How is it that this man has learning when he has never studied?'" In chapter 8, in verse 48, "The Jews answered him, 'Are we not right in saying that you are a Samaritan and have a demon?'" In chapter 9, in verse 29, "We know that God has spoken to Moses, but as for this man, we do not know where he comes from." They're constantly judging him. It wasn't always negative. In chapter 6, they said, "Is this the prophet? Let's make him be king." In chapter 11, in chapter 12, at the triumphal entry, they shouted out, "Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, even the King of Israel." They were constantly judging who Jesus was and discussing this and making judgments upon the person of Jesus Christ throughout his ministry. And we see the climax of their judgment is on the cross. The final judgment, the final culmination, the conclusion that the people made of Jesus is seen in the cross in chapter 19, in verse 7. "The Jews answered him, 'We have a law, and according to that law he ought to die, because he has made himself the Son of God. We've got to kill him.'" In chapter 19, verse 15, they cried out, "Away with him, away with him, crucify him." And Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." We are choosing a pagan, idolatrous, evil, wicked human ruler over the Savior of the world. We are going to choose this earthly kingdom over the kingdom of God, in which we claim we have been awaiting. That is their final conclusion, is to hang Jesus as a heretic, to hang him in the most humiliating manner possible. What does that say about the world? What does that say about the depravity of which man is born under? That was the world's part in the cross. And what is amazing about this, and that we have to think deeply about, is the implications of Jesus saying now is the judgment of the world, because that was just the world's part. In 1 John, we learn that it's the Father that sent the Son, the second person of the Trinity, was sent to provide himself as an acceptable sacrifice. Meaning, Christ going to the cross was part of God's plan. 1 John 4:10 says this, and this is love. That not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. That Jesus was sent by God, that Jesus voluntarily went, and it was completely voluntary that Christ went. In verse 27 of chapter 12 of John, now is my soul troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. But for this purpose I have come to this hour. The Father sends the Son comes voluntarily. The Son gives up his life on the cross. But the means by which this was accomplished was at the hands of sinful men. And Jesus says, now is the judgment of this world. Did God force them to place Jesus on the cross? I mean, you got to think about that. God's plan was not going to be thwarted by chance. Did God force them? I think the way to answer this question might be helpful to consider it from another angle. And I'd like to look at the Exodus for a second, because I think it applies. In the Exodus, God sent Moses, who was the first mediator, to Pharaoh to free his people Israel, to free them from the bondage that they were under. And Pharaoh refused several times to release the people, despite all of the plagues and the supernatural things that were taking place, the miracles that were taking place. And repeatedly we read the words, Pharaoh hardened his heart. And we don't have any problem with that, do we? That Pharaoh hardened his heart. He was evil, he was wicked. Scripture doesn't teach us that he was a good guy, but that he was a wicked person. He was brutal to the Israelites. He was paranoid, and he hardened his heart. That's not hard to understand. That's very simple. But then in other places, we read some unnerving verses. In chapter 9, verse 16 of Exodus, but for this purpose I have raised you up, God speaking to Pharaoh, to show you my power so that my name may be proclaimed in all the earth. In other words, all of this is taking place, and I'm showing my power through you, Pharaoh. In chapter 10, verse 1, we read these words, then the Lord said to Moses, go into Pharaoh, for I have hardened his heart and the heart of his servants. I didn't just harden Pharaoh's hearts, but I also hardened his servants' hearts. In chapter 10, verse 27, but the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart, and he would not let them go. What is interesting, as I probably get asked about that more than any other verse, but I never get asked about the verse, now is the time for this world to be judged. You see, the same question must be asked of the cross and Jesus. The very event that the Exodus foreshadowed, we see the same situation. Now is the judgment of this world, that it was yet still part of God's plan. You see the difficulty in this, don't you? I think Martin Luther's helpful in his book, Bondage of the Will. He wrote, and I'm paraphrasing, completely paraphrasing, he said, God did not put anything in Pharaoh's heart that was not already there. God didn't have to put evil in Pharaoh's heart because evil was already in his heart. God didn't have to put evil into these men's heart because evil was already in their heart by way of natural birth in Adam. He didn't have to put evil in anybody's heart. It was already there. We have to properly understand that. And he says this, now is the judgment of this world. It's a judgment of that evilness that is in their heart. And it really reveals two judges, doesn't it? The world judged Christ and killed him, and the world continues to judge Christ. And the world would kill Christ today if they could. But the judgment the world puts on Christ makes them to be that of God's judgment. The world is judged by what it did to Jesus. Wickedness is judged by what it did to Jesus. And Jesus says in chapter 8, verse 44 of John, you are of your father the devil, and your will is to do your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning that does not stand in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks out of his own character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. When they lied at Jesus' trial, they were acting like their father. When they hung Christ on the cross, they were acting like their father. That was what was in them. God didn't put that there. And the irony is their judgment on Christ was really a judgment upon themselves, wasn't it? Now think about that for a second. All of our actions, all of our words, our way of life really becomes a judgment upon ourselves. And let that sink in for a second. Our actions, our words, our way of life is actually a judgment upon ourselves. We don't have to be judged by anyone else. We just simply do the things that we do, and that speaks for itself. But ultimately, what this is speaking of has to do with what they did with Jesus. And what judgment has to do today with you and I and everyone else that ever lives is has to do with this one single thing. What do you do with Jesus? Chapter 5, verse 23. Then all may honor the Son, just as they honor the Father. Whoever does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. What do you do with Jesus? Jesus says, now is this judgment. Judgment began. But it's something that has always been there, and that's clear from the early chapters of John, and beginning in verse 19 of chapter 3, and this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and people love the darkness rather than the light, because their works were evil. As Pastor Ben always tells me, is we just love our sin. We just love that darkness. Verse 36 of the same chapter, whoever believes in the Son has eternal life. Whoever does not obey the Son shall not see his life. But the wrath of God remains on him. It's there and it will remain there. And in chapter 5, verse 24, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life. He does not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life. We don't have to go into judgment. We can pass from death to life. While there is a final judgment at the end of the age, Jesus also teaches this very simple reality is now is the judgment of this world. And guess what? By that judgment, by God's wrath remaining on those that reject his Son, God is glorified in the execution of his perfect righteous justice. We will not be in heaven and saying, boy, God, you were not just in the exercise of your just righteousness. We won't say, God, you really messed up on that judgment there. That person really should be here. Judgment is based upon what you do with Jesus. Now, you see the scope, you see the depth of this epidemic, don't you? The world kills Jesus, who was perfect in truth and love and grace and mercy. It really makes sense when we read Paul quoting the Psalms, no one is righteous, no, not one. It's hard to argue with Paul saying that when we look to the cross and see that it was wickedness that hung Christ on the cross. You see, the cross demonstrates the bleakness of our sin, the depth of our sin. That's the first victory of the cross, as judgment of this world. And there's a second victory. It's seen in the second now statement. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. You see, our previous sentence had two judgments. And this sentence has two rulers. There's a ruler of this world, but he will be cast out. Doesn't that indicate that there's a greater ruler? Satan is a ruler, but he is subservient to God. He has no power over God. He can only do that which he is allowed to do.
Amen.
And his end is determined, and the means of his end is also determined. Listen, friends. He's not a red creature with horns that walks around with a pitchfork and looks like a cartoon character. He is a very dangerous enemy. And praise be to God that we see his final end in Revelation. In chapter 20, in verse 10, it says this, "And the devil, who had deceived them, was thrown into the lake of fire and sulfur, where the beast and the false prophet were, and they will be tormented day and night forever and ever." And that is the final casting out of Satan. Yet Jesus here speaks of him being cast out now. And this refers to, I believe, his influence. There are a few things that we should look at. Satan is called the ruler of this world in John. In Ephesians 2:2, he's called the prince of the power of the air. 2 Corinthians 4:4, he's called the god of this world. John 8:44, a verse we looked at, he's a murderer. He's the father of lies. In Revelation 12:9, he's called the deceiver. In verse 10, he's called an accuser of believers. In 1 John 5:19, he's called the evil one. He's the ruler of this world. And Jesus says, now he will be cast out. And the powerful being, this powerful being that Satan is, he is completely subservient to God. And his power was dramatically lessened even at the coming of Jesus in the first kingdom. Jesus says this in Luke chapter, or he doesn't say this, this is what we read in chapter 10 of Luke. Verse 17, the 72 returned with joy, saying, "Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name." The lessening of power of this at the outcoming of Jesus' kingdom, the coming of the kingdom in Jesus, we already see this taking place. In verse 18, Jesus, and he said to them, "I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven." That's in the perfect tense. It's continual, continuously taking place. The cross, it seemed like it was Satan's triumph, but it was actually his defeat, because Jesus says he's cast out. And we see his authority lessening as the kingdom of God came. And at this point, I think it's helpful to, D.A. Carson writes this, "But the fundamental smashing of his reign," that is Satan's reign, "of tyranny takes place in the death, exaltation of Jesus." He continues to write, "When Jesus was glorified, lifted up to heaven, by means of the cross, enthroned, then too was Satan dethroned." What a powerful imagery. By means of the cross, Jesus enthroned, then Satan dethroned. What I love about this verse, and I hope this brings you comfort, is that Satan is completely helpless and impotent in his reign. Now will the ruler of this world be cast out. It's in the passive tense. And as I was studying this, that kept coming back to this passive tense and thinking about it. It's that there is nothing that Satan can do about this. There's nothing he can do against the power of God. It's not like that God's got to try really hard to cast him out. It's not like that Satan has all this power that he's going to be able to thwart God's program, or he's going to maybe be able to prevent what takes place, or that he has a fighting chance, that there's some sort of statistical odds that Satan might conquer over God. There are none. He's completely helpless against the power of God. But yet, we would be foolish to not recognize that he is a powerful being. You read this interesting verse in Jude 9, but when the archangel Michael, contending with the devil, was disputing about the body of Moses, he did not presume to pronounce a blasphemous judgment, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." This is the archangel Michael. Doesn't say, "Lord, I," or say, "Satan, I rebuke you." He says, "The Lord rebuke you." And we take that way too lightly. I was one time praying with a group of men in my office. This is a completely true story. And we were praying, and one of the men started in his prayer, "Satan, I rebuke you." I thought, what? I almost fell over. Michael, the archangel, stands before him and contending with the body of Moses says, "Lord, rebuke you." We don't rebuke him. We have to be very careful with that. But as powerful and influential he may be, his fate is on an irreversible path of doom. It's set. You know, that's the futility of following Satan. It's a path of doom. It's a path of being conquered, because he has been conquered. It's following a path that is not going to produce any fruit in your life. What does it mean to follow Satan? I think two things. First is to believe his lies about sin. Believe his lies about sin, and in essence, you are following him. Believe that he says you can compromise your faith. Believe him when he says that you can compromise and do little things that are sinful in the sight of God. Believe him when he says, don't listen to God's word, but listen to man's word. That's to follow his instruction. In an ultimate sense, it's believing, though, his lies about Jesus. And that's the ultimate following of Satan, is to believe what he says to you about Jesus. And that is following him. But his end is in sight, and it began at the cross. And Jesus says, now will the ruler of this world be cast out. I think that there's a little bit of help for understanding this just as one other point. In Acts chapter 26, Paul, before Agrippa, is telling of his conversion, and he recounts the story in Acts 26, and he says this, Jesus is saying this to him, and the Lord said, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting, but rise and stand upon your feet, for I have prepared to you for this purpose, to appoint you as a servant and witness to the things in which you have seen me, and to those in which I will appear to you, delivering you from your people and from the Gentiles to whom I'm sending to you, to open their eyes so that they may turn from darkness to light," listen, "and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and in place among those who are sanctified by faith in me." If we want to understand truly what it means when we say now the ruler of this world is cast out, read Acts 26, verse 18, is that we turn from darkness to light and from the power of Satan to God, that we may receive forgiveness of sins. He's cast out in that moment. And we need to look at that as we understand what it's saying. But there's a third victory. We see the first victory is judgment of the world. The second victory is the judgment over this world. And the third victory is this, "And I," Jesus speaking, "and I, when I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all people to myself." This verse begins with a condition, and don't miss it, "when I am lifted up." That's a conditional statement. The result of Jesus being lifted up is this, "he will draw all people to himself," he says. We've looked at this universal epidemic. Here's the only remedy. This is the only remedy in sight. This is the only option. This is the only cure. There's only one salvation. to the problem of sin, and it is the cross. There is only one escape from death, and it is the cross. The cross is the greatest act of love. And it's the greatest act of love, listen, is manifested by the greatest act of brutality and depravity. And the one who suffered, suffered voluntarily. This is the only solution to the epidemic. We are saved by looking to the completed work of Christ on the cross. The cross is our message. By no other means is man saved, 1 Corinthians 2:2, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and Him crucified. The cross is our message, because there is no access to God apart from the cross. Why is the cross essential to our faith, you may wonder? And we could give you all sorts of theological reasons, but let me just read the Bible. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified by His grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by His blood, to be received by faith. This was to show God's righteousness, because in His divine forbearance He had passed over former sins. It was to show His righteousness at the present time, so that He might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Cross is absolutely essential to your salvation. For salvation to be possible, Jesus had to be lifted up. I think that we can better understand this. There's almost a double meaning here of lifted up. Isaiah 52:13, He shall be high and lifted up and shall be exalted. The word or phrase lifted up is the same as to be exalted. And I want to draw you this to your attention here, is the cross is the climactic point for both humiliation and exaltation. It is both the climactic point of wrath and mercy. It is the culmination of judgment and forgiveness. It is where we see the most extreme violence and the most beautiful peace offered. What contrast we see on the cross, isn't it? We must look to the cross. For when we look to the cross, we find mercy, we find forgiveness, we find peace. For in the cross, we find salvation. When we have looked to the cross for salvation, we must continue to look to the cross for our message, for our method, and for our strategy. Any gospel presentation absent of the cross is not a gospel presentation. So many people view the cross as being obscene. One so-called theologian says it's cosmic child abuse. What ridiculous statements.
Amen.
At the cross, all people will be drawn. And this is the answer the Greeks were seeking. The Greeks wanted to meet with Jesus. And Jesus gives them the answer in this: all men. Yes, all men, even me. Yes, all men, even you. There's nothing that we've done that could keep us from the cross, except for to continue rejecting the saving power of the cross by looking to the completed work of Christ. Why? Sin stands in our way. But yet it's sin that is the very need for the cross. Because we've all sinned, we've all fallen short. And it's on the cross. It's on the cross that your sin is imputed to Christ and Christ's righteousness is imputed to you. You receive mercy at the cross, propitiation. Verse 33, a little commentary. He said this to show by what kind of death he was going to die. It defines what it means, lifted up, is that he was going to go to the cross. It governs what is meant by there. But it's still the same word as exalted. And the crowd that understood that Jesus who called himself the Son of Man in verse 23, was referring to his death. As they, Jesus said this, they understood it was death. Their question, who is the Son of Man? It's really, what kind of Son of Man are you? They were thinking of passages like Psalm 72, verse 17, may his name endure forever and his fame continue long as the sun. Perhaps they were thinking of passages like Isaiah 9, verse 7, of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end on the throne of David and over his kingdom to establish it and to uphold it with justice and righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. When they looked to Jesus, they saw someone that was going to be conquering, that was going to last forever, that the throne of David, when the Messiah came, would last forever. So the idea of the Messiah dying, especially a death on the cross, was absolutely unthinkable. And this is why they say what they say. It's why Paul stated what he stated, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and folly to Gentiles. The cross was unthinkable for them. And Paul even says it's a stumbling block to Jews. Friends, it's a stumbling block to people today. And it's folly to people today. Why would God have to send his son to die for sin? And that doesn't make any sense. Couldn't he just make it all better? Yeah, he did, by sending his son to the cross. It was true that the Messiah would be victorious. It's true that the Messiah was eternal. But they didn't have the complete picture. And that's why many Jews to this very day interpret Psalm 53 as the servant, suffering servant, as being Israel. Because the cross is a stumbling block to them. The cross is still that stumbling block to people. Unless they realize and have a realization of their sin. Because unless you first realize your sin, you have no need for the cross. You don't need your sin to be nailed to the cross if you don't realize that you're a sinner. And they didn't see their need for Jesus. I love this. Jesus in his love warns them. He says this, the light is among you for a little while longer. Walk while you have the light, lest darkness overtake you. The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he is going. While you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. The point is simple. Jesus is saying to them, look guys, I'm just here a little while longer. Wherever Jesus was at, from his standpoint, talking to these people, he's about ready to go to the cross. He's days away, and he's saying, I'm just here with you a little bit longer. I am the light of this world. Darkness is coming, and I'm leaving. Jesus gives again this startling statement to them. He tells them their condition. The one who walks in the darkness does not know where he's going. You have light or darkness. That's your choice. While the light from the Christian perspective is an obvious desire, that we would want to walk in the light, it's not so for those that are apart from the light. For what did we learn about those that are apart from the light? They love darkness. The one who walks in darkness, it literally means this is the walking one. The walking one. It speaks of a wandering life of confusion, open to stumble, and a life of stumbling. Not having any basis for understanding why there is life, no consistency in life. And it's a life of certain judgment, it's a life of certain defeat. It's a life of stumbling and wandering in the darkness. That's why life is a struggle when we try to do it our way. You know, old Blue Eyes sang the beautiful song, I Did It My Way. That could be the theme song of our culture, but I did it my way. You know, as much as I love that song, I'm afraid that that is the attitude of so many. I'm going to do it my way. I'm not going to do it God's way. But Jesus identifies to do things my way rather than his way is to do it as a way of stumbling and wandering in darkness. And I'm sure even Blue Eyes knows that now. You see, chaos entered the world with sin. For if God's word is the basis and the standard and definition of truth, and there is no other truth apart from God, all truth in Christ, all wisdom in Christ, to live apart from his light is to live a life that pretending up is down and down is up and right is left and left is right, that there's no such thing as gravity, that the sky is purple rather than blue. But it doesn't have to be that way. It didn't have to be that way for this group of people. Jesus was there with them, and he said to them, while you have the light, believe in the light, that you may become sons of light. He told them that they could become something. That means that they weren't already what he said they could become. That they could become sons of light. And his point was very simple. Make the decision while you can. While there is still time. While you have the time, make the decision. Make that decision now, he says. And I think just an act of that demonstrated his words. Jesus concludes all of this. And we read, when Jesus had said these things, he departed and hid himself from them. Most commentators view that as an act of parable. That Jesus did that as a way of communicating his words. That he left them and hid from them. It's not uncommon for me to get, for the church to get a phone call like the one that was received on Friday. A man calling, his wife was being pulled off of life support. Mm-hmm. And Linda brought the message to me, and I called him, and he asked me if I would go to the hospital and pray with his family, and so I did. And he didn't expect to be there last year with his wife of 52 years dying. He didn't expect that. That's the reality, friends, of death. We just don't know when it's going to happen. And we have no idea when that's going to happen. It was January of 1850 in England. It was snowing outside. A young man of 15 years old who was cold. He stumbled into a primitive Methodist chapel to escape the snow of England. He was on a side street. As he walked in, there was a lay preacher. The regular preacher wasn't there. There was a man that just stood up and said, I'll preach. Wasn't a very good preacher. Wasn't an expositor whatsoever. And his text was Isaiah 45, 22. Look to the Lord and be saved. And this preacher just kept reading that over over again, look, emphasizing the words look, look. And this 15-year-old young boy who had grown up in a Christian home, had a long lineage of Christian pastors and preachers in his family, who was well-versed in the works of the Puritans, felt the weight of his sin at that moment and realized that he was on a crash course of destiny leading straight to hell. And it was at that moment that Charles Haddon Spurgeon looked to the cross. Wow. Because it was in the cross that he found salvation. And he found that his guilt was finally removed. What is the remedy? Look to the cross. Look to the cross. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the cross. We thank you for the completed work of Jesus on it. There's nothing that we could do or say that could earn it. It is purely by your grace. Thank you. Thank you. I pray, Father, for the one that does not know you, that you would draw them now. I pray for those that are struggling, that you would point them to the cross, that they would be reminded that there's forgiveness and healing in it. Thank you for Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen.